This is Johanna.
And Nicke from Lucifer.
And you're listening to Sonic Perspectives.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another interview of Sonic Perspectives. I'm Rodrigo, and my guests today are Johanna and Nicke from Lucifer. Guys, thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us, Rodrigo.
It's a pleasure. We are here to promote, of course, the new album, 4. To my ears, this is a more collaborative effort than your other three albums. Am I right in saying that?
Yeah.
Yes.
You are right.
Yeah, I think, when 2 came out, I interviewed both you guys, and Nicke said he was more used to writing by himself until you guys started working together. I guess you're comfortable with that approach by now, right, Nicke?
Oh, totally. I was comfortable right away, but it was the first time I'd really done it that way with Johanna. And now, you know, it's the third album we did together, and that, you know, it seems even easier, maybe,
right?
You know, we know how it works, and then Linus, our guitar player, now he did 2 songs with Johanna.
Next album,
I'm not gonna be writing anything.
We'll see.
Useless for now.
But when it comes to writing, what comes first? Is it the lyrics, the riffs, the concept, or
usually the riffs?
Well, that's the most common thing, that I have a music idea, like a sketch that I actually send to Johanna, even though we're in the same house.
Right.
And then she works on that with the lyrics, melodies, phrasing, and, you know, turning it into a song. And then we talk about that, you know, if there's any arrangement things. And that's the most common way we do it. And that's the way Johanna and Linus did too. But sometimes it differs. There's been a few songs where Johanna had the vocal melody and even the lyrics maybe before. And then I try to put music around that kind of. And then on the new album, there's Mausoleum, which Johanna wrote without any interference from other band members.
Okay. Well, the way I hear it or see it, 4 is a more immersive experience. I wouldn't say there's a concept or the album, but there's an atmosphere that involves you around the songs. And I found that it's better experience if you listen to it as a whole. Don't you think?
Yeah, I think Lucifer is an album band. And we are not a conceptual band like King Diamond or somebody like that, right? But so every song stands kind of for itself. But there is a way also how we track list the songs, the sequence of the songs, that, it's supposed to be, a trip through an album.
Yeah,
and I do agree that this one, even though it was not intentional, kind of have more of a concept feel, even though it isn't a concept behind it. With the cover art and the songs and some of the lyrics.
Yeah, it unintentionally maybe turned a little bit into a little bit more of a concept than any of the other Lucifer albums.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think you're going to get this question in every interview, but tell me about the cover. It's just incredible and shocking.
I love it. Okay, incredible and shocking. I can totally live with that. my mom thought it was shocking. So that was my first test person. Said, oh no, my daughter, what are you doing?
She was kind of afraid that people were going to be really angry with her and get targeted.
Yeah. She even said, you know, somebody will shoot you for it. You know, it's like, oh, great. Thanks, Mom. but that's cool, you know, because I do believe that in rock music, I guess it's hard to shock people, and you wouldn't think, you know, 50 years after a Black Sabbath album came out, that there's still some sort of way to shock anybody. And I mean, it wasn't really, it wasn't the intention to shock anybody, but the intention was to have a cover that sticks out from the mass and something that's somehow timeless. But of course, there's also a meaning behind it. And yeah, I mean, long story short, you know, being a female singer in a band sometimes feels a little bit like being a witch on a stake.
I get, yeah, I totally understand.
Yeah, so that, you know, I'm playing with that, and it's, yeah, it's yeah. my fuck you to people who don't believe that a woman can do that.
Yeah. And I like how there's a different treatment of the cover every time a new album of yours comes out. The first one was like a drawing. The second one was a picture of the band. Third one was, you know, the band, but like in a cartoonish kind of way. And now this very artistic photo with such a statement, right?
Yeah, that's actually, it's true. I mean, I always try to do something that's not expected. The first album had this turquoise gold, which is completely the opposite colors of what a band that plays doom would do. You know, they're probably expecting something that looks like an Electric Wizard cover or something. And then I thought, okay, so next album, this time it's going to be the band, you know. And then we had the idea for the painting. And now it was something different again. I think it's good to say, you know, interesting somehow.
Yeah.
I don't want to get bored with myself either, you know.
Of course. And speaking of visuals, the video for Bring Me His Head is amazing too. I think you came up with the concept and the Carrie reference, right, Johanna?
Yeah, I thought it could be a cool idea.
And I like how it ends with "to be continued," and then crucifix shows the scene after you get your revenge, right?
Yeah, well, it's more like somebody took revenge on me and bring me his head. So here I am, resurrected and more evil than ever.
Yeah, yeah. The cool effect of those videos is that you keep wondering what happened in between, you know, after you get the bucket of blood in your head and then you're walking in the street. What happened in between those scenes, right?
I want to know that too.
In between... Okay, I can tell you what happened in between. We had a lunch break and had some pizza.
Right.
Spoiler.
Yeah. Yeah. And I remember you directed the California Sun video. Will you be doing more of this in the future? Or you have, like, those two videos are fantastic, the ones for the new album, right? So
I never really directed anything. I think I just have ideas how I want, what I want. And then I have to ask other people to do it.
Fair enough.
So but yes, I am very, I usually I mean, I'm very clear in what I want. So Nicke and I, we have a lot of ideas for visual things, and something, you know, shapes up in our heads, and then it's like, oh yes, let's do this is great, you know. And then yeah, so I don't think it will be a problem in the future to make up new nonsense.
Right. Wild Horses is another great single, and the lyrics speak of a pact made by two people, a morbid covenant, right? Can you explain the concept of that one? And is it a pun on the Rolling Stones' Wild Horses or not?
Yes, it is, of course. Yeah. We are both, Nicke and I, are big Stones fans, and I guess everybody in the band.
Right.
So I was actually, when it came into my head, Wild Horses. Why, yeah. You know, and then I googled it, was like, has nobody else done that? No, great, then I can take it. The Morbid Covenant, that's Nicke and me. It's basically, it's my love song to my husband, Nicke.
Awesome.
Yeah. Our satanic marriage.
Yeah. Yes, I love that. A lot of bands have this kind of long-term plan that goes like, on this album I plan to reach this or that market, when the next one comes out I want to be at this or that level. I don't know if you guys planned this sort of way or not, but I think to me Lucifer 2 was a game changer for the band in terms of popularity. 3 cemented that reputation, and 4 I think it's going to open new doors, right?
I have no idea, but it's nice to hear you say that. I don't think, I mean, what I've learned from being in in the music business, or what you want to call it, is to have no expectations whatsoever. You can't really tell, you know.
No.
It's like, and if you do, you're probably gonna get disappointed. It's better to go about things with like, yeah, we'll see what happens, you know.
Right.
Of course, what we can do is set the bars musically for us. That's what we can do. And then we can just cross our fingers and hope.
The thing is, you know, we don't have a 5-year plan or whatever, you know, I don't think I ever even heard about it. We don't even have a management, you know, we do everything ourselves. And if, you know, basically we just want to play and record music that we love. And if that works and other people like that too, then that's awesome. I mean, yeah, of course it would be great to sell more records, you know, but like Nicke says, you know, we enjoy what we're doing and it's good for what it is now. As long as we don't sell less records.
It's okay, right?
I'm okay. Yeah. You know?
I think you can actually see some bands, especially younger bands, that have a plan or a goal, mm-hmm. and they do get disappointed, you know? And then you have to ask yourself, why are you doing this really? Are you doing it because you really enjoy what you're doing, or do you actually expect to make it a career? You know, and
yeah.
If that's what you're after, I think you might be doing it for the wrong reasons.
Right.
I'm not sure. I mean, that's just how it feels to me, because then you're probably going to start thinking about how are people going to perceive this? And,
yeah.
you know, then you're lost already.
I think it's better to react and to play to your own instincts as opposed to, you know, thinking of what people might think and react to it, right?
Exactly. And that's what we do.
Yeah. Speaking of plans, I have I'm curious about what you're going to name the next album, because it's 1, 2, 3, and 4. Are you going to continue with the numbers, or are you going to go the Led Zeppelin route and, you know, no, start next, with?
Next one's going to be called 6.
Okay.
Awesome.
Just to keep it clear, right? Yeah, Chickenfoot did that. They did 1, and the second album's called 3. So,
really? That is
That is awesome.
Yeah. And you're planning a record release night in Stockholm on October 28th. What can the fans expect of that night? You're going to play the album in full, or?
Yes.
We're not going to play at all.
No, yeah, exactly. So we are actually not playing a show, and this is really a party. So
for us, basically.
So
okay,
we are DJing, and we invited, you know, all our friends and people who were involved in the album and videos, and anyone can come. The door is open, and we're gonna DJ. You know, we're just gonna play the music that we love and have drinks, and you know. Have fun.
Oh, awesome. Awesome. Yeah. I looked at a few tour dates that you have, and one of them caught my attention, the Beyond the Gates Festival, where Merciful Fate is also going to play Candlemass, Opeth. That's going to be an incredible one, right?
Yes. Yeah. I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah. This will be a special night. I wish I could travel right now and go see you guys, but... Yeah. And you have a terrifying schedule for November too. I think from November 12 until November 28, there are hardly any days off. Shows booked almost back to back, right?
Yeah. Yeah. It's going to be
intense.
Intense. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. And Nicke, I read yesterday that Entombed is going to reunite for a special concert too at a Sweden festival, right? What can the fans expect?
They can expect the unexpected.
Awesome.
I can't really go into more detail there. I'm just very excited about it, that we're gonna do this, and it's just not gonna be any regular show. It's gonna be a little extra.
So okay. you might want to book a plane ticket.
You might
maybe.
It's going to be better, I can tell you.
And this is a one-off, right? There's no plans to at least do like a few songs together or nothing like that?
Well, I can't go into too much detail at the moment. We are gonna start with this one.
Okay.
What happened?
Yeah, right now I'm like Jim Carrey on Dumb and Dumber. So you're saying there's a chance, you know? But I'll wait to hear.
I'm not saying there's not a chance.
Okay, okay. I'll wait to hear through the official channels. and I know you guys released a few covers during COVID, right? As Lucifer or collaborating with other artists as well. But it must be refreshing to show some new music to the fans, right?
Yeah, always. I mean, we love...
For us too.
Yeah. It's fun to write your own stuff, but it's also a lot of fun to cover things, you know, and to take it through the Lucifer machine. And because we had so much time on our hands, you know, what else are you going to do?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Johanna, did you have a reference point as a female singer when you started? Because, you know, it's more common now, but when you started, there were hardly anyone, right? I think we had Lita Ford in the 80s and maybe Doro from Germany back then, but...
No, my reference points were, I don't know, Glenn Danzig, Ozzy Osbourne.
Right.
Robert Plant, you know, mostly guys, you know.
Okay. I like how you guys do a lot of covers, like on the encore of the shows as well. When you played here in Toronto, you did Beer Drinkers and Hellraisers from ZZ Top, which is cool. Yeah. And Nicke took guitar as well, I think, right? Did you play guitars or bass? I can't remember.
The bass is much easier to play upside down. Since
Yeah. I'm left-handed too.
Yeah, sometimes it's a pain in the ass, but that's how it is.
Yeah, like you can't just go into a music store and try everything, right? Because there's hardly any left-handed instruments available sometimes. But
yeah, I mean, I guess you can try it, but it's not going to be so fun.
Yeah. Well, for Lucifer 2, you guys did, I think, 3 legs in North America. Is there any chance of you guys coming back sometime soon or?
Absolutely. Yeah. We actually want to come back next year. We are just waiting for a few more visas to come through because I've got mine, but not the rest of the band.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. But I guess it's due to the pandemic, you know, all these
it takes time.
These offices, they are like overloaded, I'm guessing, with like different procedures. But also, you know, now the travel ban from the US is going to be lifted. So we couldn't make any plans before that, you know, because we didn't know how long it's going to be. But now there's a light at the end of the tunnel. So hopefully we are coming next year.
Yeah. Oh, hopefully. Yeah. I mean, I have fond memories of the Toronto show you guys did in 2019. I don't know if you remember, but you did an in-store appearance just before the show. I took my daughter. She was, she was 4 back then. I still have a picture of her holding the Lucifer poster. So.
Oh, I remember the in-store, of course. And I also remember because we had a few in-stores on that and there was a few little kids.
It's always cool.
Yeah. Oh, well, I hope I get to see you guys again sometime soon. I'll keep my fingers crossed and I hope to hear about the touring plans shortly.
Thank you so much. Okay. It was a pleasure.
Yeah, likewise. Thank you guys. All the best with Lucifer 4.
Thank you. Be safe.
Cheers.
Nice talking to you. Take care.
Likewise. Bye.
Okay, everyone. Thank you for tuning in and I hope you enjoyed this interview with Johanna and Nicke from Lucifer. We'd love to hear your thoughts, so leave us a comment on this video. Also, the interview is available on many different platforms, YouTube, iTunes, Stitcher, Google Podcasts, and iHeartRadio. We encourage you to check it out anywhere and to follow us on Twitter and Facebook. To finish off, we'll play the song Bring Me His Head from Lucifer's 4th album. Stay safe, and we'll see you soon.